Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Diller. My name is Matilde Guidelli. I'm Diller's associate curator and the organizer of the Artist on Artist lecture series, where since 2001 we invite an artist to reflect upon the work of another artist in Diller's collection and past program. The idea animating the series is to foster discourse across generations and perspectives and to offer a platform for artists to develop conversations that are often already active in their studio. And I am pleased to introduce tonight's very special event featuring Naeem Mohaiemen with Marina Tabassum on Diller and Scofidio. When I first contacted Naeem and proposed him to take part in the series, our conversation ended up veering towards architecture, which, as many of you know, is a quiet but crucial component in Naeem's films. We also exchanged our personal failures and perhaps mutual aspirations towards architecture. And so I was not too surprised when he told me that he had chosen to respond to the work of the only architects in the long list of artists who have been commissioned by Diller over the years, that is, Diller and Scofidio. In 1998, Diller and Scofidio created Refresh for Diller's Artists World Project series. It was the heydays of webcams, and for their commission, Diller and Scofidio placed live cameras in 12 offices around the world. They fabricated a narrative for each location to reflect on the effect of live video on everyday life, and the project was called Refresh because you could refresh the feed and a fragmentary timeline would be created that then they used as their storyboard. For his talk tonight, Naeem reshuffled the parameters of the original project by bringing an Insta360 camera in the Dhaka office of Marina Tabassum Architects. And that gesture led to the performative lecture that we will hear in a moment, which will be followed by a conversation with Marina herself. And it will become clear at the personal and political level why Naeem chose to engage Marina. This approach is typical of Naeem's work, which, as many of you know, combines film, photography, and essays to research forms of utopia and dystopia, beginning from South Asia's two post-colonial markers, 1947 and 1971, and radiating out world to transnational alliances and collision in the Muslim world after 1945. Naeem uniquely interrogates political movements that have perhaps remained an unreliable memory because of their failure, and he often weaves politics with family structures and stories. He grounds his works in architectures that are monuments to these unresolved histories, and the pace juxtaposition with the materiality of the architecture often contributes to push the political and personal narratives at the edge of truth. Naeem's recent film, Jolie d'Aubena, is currently on view at Front International in Cleveland through October 2nd, and a solo exhibition of his work is upcoming this November at Colby College in Maine. Naeem's forthcoming books include Midnight Third Child and Solidarity Must Be Defended. Marina Tabassum is an award-winning architect and educator. She founded the Dhaka-based firm Marina Tabassum Architects in 2005, after 10 years as a partner and co-founder of Urbana, also in Dhaka. She is the founder and chair of the Foundation for Architecture and Community Equity and chair of the board of Prokriti. In addition to lecturing widely, Marina has taught at Harvard, at the Technical University in Delft, at the University of Texas at Arlington, and at Brack University in Dhaka. Her numerous honors include the Lisbon Triennale Lifetime Achievement Award, the Aga Khan Award for Architecture, the Arnold Brunner Memorial Prize from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, the Gold Medal of the French Academy of Architecture, the Soane Medal from Sir John Soane Museum in London, and the Jameel Prize from the Victoria and Albert Museum, also in London. And before passing it on to Naeem, I wish to thank my colleagues at Diller who helped making tonight's possible, and in particular, Sarah Tucker, head of IT at Diller and producer of Diller's pioneering series of artist web projects in the 90s, and Max Dannon, who runs the tech for us tonight. And now, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Naeem Mohaiemen to the podium.
Thank you, Matilde, for the wonderful introduction to both myself and Marina Tabassum, who we are thrilled to have in the audience. She's just come in from Bangladesh just last week, so it's a great piece of serendipity of timing. You know, of the people that Matilde mentioned, of course, thanks to everybody, but especially Sarah Tucker, because during this process, one of the things she did was revive the original project. When we first went through the list of historic projects that had been done under this DIA series, the Diller Scofidio project had some icons, but when you clicked on them, they didn't lead anywhere. Because if I'm not mistaken, it was also an old form of JavaScript. And one of the things Sarah Tucker did leading up to now is actually revive the website so that it's now working with brand new HTML coding. So we were actually able to see it. And then we also did something with it. As Matilde mentioned, architecture is one of my obsessions. And it's an obsession that comes from a place of an early failure, which I'll also talk about today a little bit. And the specter of architects who engage with the arts is these days quite familiar. Marina Tabassum herself has shown at the Sharjah Architecture Triennial, Jamil and Whitechapel, among several others. But when Diller Scofidio did their project in 1998, it was a very unfamiliar thing. It was not typical at all. And one of the things that I did when I first found out about the project is I also presumed that Diller Scofidio, who today are known as Diller Scofidio Renfro, must have done an architecture project, drawings, model, 3D rendering, something like that, something that I'm used to or expect. And it was quite a surprise when we actually went and finally found the fully realized project and saw a quite wacky fiction film, basically, using the 12 webcams of 12 offices, which is also the conceit of the project. What I had said to Matilde is what I'd like to do, and this is also from not really fully knowing what the Diller Scofidio project was, because both me and Matilde were working off of one web page, is I said, okay, look, this original project is 12 offices, and it says it's for 365 days, a whole year. So I'm going to reverse it. I'm going to make it one day and one office. And this last part of it is a sort of expected gesture. All 12 of the offices were northern offices. They were either in the United States, Australia, or in Europe. And I said, okay, it's going to be just in Bangladesh, this one country, one city, Dhaka, which is kind of a hub for a certain kind of architecture that Marina and I will also talk about afterwards. And so that also came from this expectation that this must have been a project done in 1998 when maybe the specter of architectural offices in Delhi, Beijing, Dubai, or Johannesburg was not yet in the horizon. What we found out later is actually Diller Scofidio chose their offices simply based on, if I'm not mistaken, who had webcams in their offices, which in 1998 turned out to be mostly technology companies, computer gear, etc. So there's Dave's World on the list. Those are the typical things. So, but we found out about that after I'd already finished filming. And so in some ways, we didn't want to, at that point, withdraw our conceit either. The second thing, which is on our side, is that we started with this idea that we're just going to have one day. And the proposition to Marina was, give us permission to film your office without sound, of course, using GoPro 360, full panopticon view, just from dawn to dusk of a single day. But we also found that to be actually extremely difficult to capture dawn to dusk. So we actually went weeks just to try to capture a single day. And I'll talk a little bit about why it was so difficult to capture a day. It's harder than you might think, actually, especially on 360 cameras, which are meant to capture action, snowboarding, surfing, et cetera, not an office that's sitting there. One thing just to orient you from where you're sitting, there are two projectors, two screens. Sometimes here, the two screens might have the same video, but for tonight, it's going to be two different videos. And so just to orient you in case at some point you decide you want to move, or if you just want to make sense of what you're seeing, channel one, which is this one, is what we've done with Marina Tabassum's office, and channel two is the original Diller Scofidio. And you might also think that one way you'll understand the difference is that that surely will be the highly pixelated video because it's from 1998, but you'll also find that sometimes this is pixelated as well. Technology still has its various constraints in 2022. So we'll start. Max, could we kill the lights and start the videos? Thanks. Between 4 and 5, he frequently glances towards the surveillance monitor. When she first appears in the elevator, he pauses and stares. Her head is usually cranked up in the direction of the display panel, or perhaps the camera. She arrived in a clean room gown, plucked two latex gloves from the dispenser, blew into each successively, and carefully stretched the rubber over one hand and then the other, pressing deep into the web between each finger. She peeled off the gloves and strapped a wrist support on her right hand. She then attached an orthopedic seat cushion to the chair, adjusted the brightness level of the monitor, and examined its surface as if it were a mirror. When she spots him in the monitor, her pace accelerates. She closes a set of windows on the screen, detaches her foam seat pad, and packs it into her tote bag, removes her sterile gown, and strips off her wrist support. They rarely cross paths. Every day is visited by a glitch. The electricity vanishes at a set time. We call it load shedding. At a fixed hour, it plunges the office into darkness. This interrupts the recharging of the battery. Eventually, the camera gives out. We lose fragments of each day.
Perfectly safe.
In The Prestige, the thin white Duke plays Nikola Tesla. His aura distracts, and so we forget about the plot line. It is said that Tesla was about to invent wireless electricity. All science fiction cinema from 1965 to 2002 are made anachronistic by this one flaw. It is the 22nd century, humans are circling the solar system, great discoveries are made, and yet somehow space explorers are still typing on a keyboard. 100 scientists typing on 100 typewriters fail to imagine touching a screen. If anyone from Xerox Lab had whispered about this, they might have replied, but that will leave smudges on the screen. I am an anti-Nostradamus in my life choices. My cousin Hassan went to MIT, and in 1996 was working on something called speech-to-command protocols. When he explained what he did in San Francisco, I could not wrap my head around it. Why would you want to talk to your computer? I don't even play music when I work. Some combination of this future blind eye, a broken angel of history, visited me during the architecture exam of 1987. I dared to sit for the exam without having studied technical drawing. There were 10 questions, and of course one was the drawing question. You were asked to do a perspective drawing of old Dhaka with a vanishing point. I really had no idea how to render that on paper. I had never been to that old part of town. Outside the exam hall, when we were finished, I redrew my submission on napkin and showed it to my cousin, Lenin. He was a year junior and sat for the same exam. He looked at my drawing and said, "Zero," meaning zero. I said, "Come now," and he repeated, "Zero." I decided to ignore him and show up on the day results were posted on the wall. I started at number 50. Maybe I had squeaked in. Nothing, nothing, nothing. And by the time I had given up, I had reached number one. And there was Marina Tabassum. That first encounter may be the origin story for why we are here 30 years later, surveilling her office, mapping how an architect's day-to-day unspools.
Daily stacks of paper collect on his desk, progressively colonizing the surface.
Naeem,
there's
a clicking sound while you're talking. Okay.
Oh.
Try it again.
1 second. I'll open the microphone. Daily stacks of paper collect on his desk, progressively colonizing the surface. They arrive from the adjoining office or from the left edge of the frame. The papers are sorted into distinct piles as they arrive. As they grow and become more fragile, they are secured with a variety of weight stored in his left-hand drawer. Typically, before the end of the day, the stacks diminish until the desk is fully cleared. I didn't read everything on words.
Shall I just do this?
His drawer holds a collection of fist-sized objects. Among them is a brass Buddha, a pink geode, how do you pronounce geode? An Eiffel Tower cast in glass, and a bust of Jesus flocked with glitter. Jesus. They might be souvenirs of past travels or gifts from his co-workers. Let's go to the next one. See that where that is. Next one. The chair was immediately spun away from the lens, but the top of the stack, remained in clear view and was now upright and more visible. The thick glass base of the ashtray simultaneously magnified and distorted a cryptic message on the top sheet. The natural light in the room slowly faded until a task lamp came on. The towers began to dwindle and vanish rapidly, one complete stack followed closely by another. Each withdrawal restored more and more of the desktop surface. The task lamp went off, and a murky figure appeared at the bottom of the frame, rounded the desk and exited through the door, dragging two large trash bags. Their plastic surfaces shimmered with amber reflections from a sodium vapor street lamp. Harsh fluorescence came on suddenly. The surface of the desk appeared matte with overlapping whorls of grain. A shallow basin that had formed under the plant produced two depressions of warped veneer that branched apart in separate directions. And then the cleaning crew always arrived at the same time. The woman dusted and polished the desktop, the man vacuumed the floor. The end.
On our second week of filming, Jesse is working late, a mid-project review for the Rohingya refugee camps, a World Food Program commission called Resilient Landscape. The buildings being built are reforestation and food outlets, one to undo the damage of the human tide from Myanmar, the other to make sure no one goes hungry. Soil goes under the ocean, and the world wants to know how we live on the edge of the drowning land. Not the drowning land, someone corrected. We are the world's largest Bo Deep, a landmass shaped like the letter Bo, I say. Bo is for Bangla, a forever faith in the link between Jomin, or soil, and Joban, speech. This is a work universe, architecture, photography, academia, shaped by the forces of external interest. A local bourgeoisie took all their money and invented in Jolus, or glamour, but not local projects. It is why the wheel of history waits for external shocks. Even modernist pioneer Mazharul Islam nominated Louis Kahn for the national parliament, not himself. "You won't get me on camera," said Marina. "I have to be out all week. Chittagong needs a lot of time." The Rohingya refugee crisis in Southeast Chittagong needs a sprawling multi-agency operation. Locals question the need for permanent structures or even comfort. If you make a warm space, the refugees may stay forever. Marina's team built a house for their own stay outside the refugee camp. Alomgir the carpenter and Pratap the engineer are in charge of cooking. Kabir is a good cook as well. Khudi Bari means small house. These structures can be dismantled without eco damage. There is a thread linking to Marina's earlier project in Sharjah about temporary homes on stilts used by people in the coastal areas. A house that can be picked up and transported and resettled. The legend of Baba Yaga's house is a frightening one. It is the destroyer. This is a much warmer alternate.
Each nail was worked with great precision, first pruning, then sanding and painting. With each stroke of the brush, she examined her work, palm down. When she was satisfied, fingers spread, she shook her hand vigorously to dry. She maintained a perfect rhythm, stroke after stroke, interminably. With each returned stroke, hairs randomly attracted by the moving brush floated up to trail its path. With every release, a tuft of fine strands cascaded down her shoulder. He stared forward aimlessly and fidgeted. He twisted the phone cord into tighter and tighter coils, twirled his wedding band in circles with his thumb, and wound the chain of his crucifix into a tight spiral, then let it spin freely. Between tasks, his attention relentlessly returned to the camera. He became more and more fascinated by its presence, and then thoroughly distracted by it, glancing constantly at the same spot. He tried to manipulate the iris and the focus. He had no clue who was watching, but wanted to communicate. He emphatically mouthed, "Hello." Then he flashed a series of handwritten notes. On the first was scribbled, "Am I good?" A second note quickly followed, asking, "Entertainment?" He approached the lens with another message scribbled on a memo pad. Not stopping for it to be read, he pushed the note against the lens, abruptly blocking the view. The pad remained in place for the rest of the day, leaking light at the sides.
After the first day, Sharif settles into the routine of being the first in to assist us with the simulation of morning. He serves us thin salty biscuits and rong cha, which we eat while setting up the cameras. Everything I instruct my students in class, I violate here. Greasy hands, biscuit crumbs, potential tea spillage, all of it near the camera body, the lens, and the power cable. Anyway, no mishap happens and we leave. In every day's footage, there is always Sharif, wondering when the day will begin. He holds a panopticon view, opens and closes the office, logs each visitor, serves tea and those delicious salty biscuits, and makes sure the cleaning lady starts on time. He knows when the office is in full flow, and when things are slow, waiting. The Rohingya refugee project saw the office vacated as the whole team was in Chittagong. This year, the office filled up as people came back. He marks all this and knows pressure is less when people are off-site. He calls me one morning and asks, "Ajke recording korben na?" He thinks, logically, that we will record every day for a full year. I explained to him that in the 1998 version of me, webcams would just turn on. But here, we have to manually set up each day. We can't keep doing this all year round. Even later, I find out that in 1998, Diller Scofidio used actors. Nothing is what you think it is anyway.
Okay, super. Thank you very much.
Punctually each morning, she filled a paper cup from the cold tap, palmed the contents of a foil packet, bent back, and swallowed. She then shook the excess water from the cup and folded it meticulously into a new configuration each day. When he arrived, he studied the pattern of indentations left by her high-heeled shoes. With an awkward precision, he traced her footsteps with his, carefully landing each step just to the side of each impression so as not to crush it. He filled his personalized drinking cup with hot water and stirred restlessly. The spoon rhythmically hit the sides of the cup, accelerating as time elapsed until the agitated liquid began to splash over the lip. She never appeared that day. He nervously tore open packet after packet of sweetener and emptied its contents into his drink, carelessly letting the wrappers fall to the floor. Checking his watch against the clock, he frequently cranked his head toward the entry. The water sat motionless for several minutes. No reflections appeared in the glass. No shadows were thrown on the walls. He entered the vestibule, emptied 4 packets of sweetener and a spoonful of powdered milk into his cup, filling it with hot water and pausing suddenly at the tap. Slowly, he poured the mixture down the drain. As she crouched to fill her cup, he entered briskly, his personalized drinking cup leading the way and drawing him directly to the other tap. For a moment, their movements were synchronized until her hand withdrew awkwardly. By this summer, the long desks with computers are gone. They had been broken into components and moved into the back office. The desks have been replaced by model-making workstations. There is a fine red dust everywhere, floating away from the small brick models. It is on every surface and crevice. No computer can survive here. Songram, an Indian architect, has joined the team. People presume he is Bengali and speak to him about the future of Bengali architecture. Eventually, he interjects and explains that he speaks English and Hindi. It may be why he is so focused on the work. All the speech acts around him are just a wall of sound. The red structure is for a small mosque in Alfadanga in Faridpur district. It is situated on a family estate belonging to a very large family scattered all around the world. There is a 200-year-old family house that a Dr. Abu Saeed has restored. This belongs to the Buraich Jomindar family. They are one of what's called the Khan Bahadurs. Now, Khan Bahadur is an amalgamation of Khan, meaning leader, and Bahadur, meaning brave, a title of respect and honor. The Khan Bahadur title was originally given in Mughal India to Muslim subjects in recognition of public service. It was then adopted by British rulers for the same reason and extended to cover other non-Hindu subjects of India. Meanwhile, Hindu subjects of British-occupied India were given the title Rai Bahadur. The legacy of the Khan Bahadurs still sediments in what was East Bengal in British India, then East Pakistan, and finally Bangladesh. This entire family of Khan Bahadur's descendants converged in restoration efforts and contributed funds. They also paid for the mosque, which has been built right outside the family home. Khan Bahadur recipients were entitled to fix the title to their name, and they were given a special title badge. It was given on behalf of the government of British India by the Viceroy and Governor General of India. They pronounced, "God save the Queen." This title was abolished in 1947 when India became independent of British rule.